we've been talking a lot about young adults being absent from the church, but young adults still have support structures out there. Can you talk a little bit about what those support structures might be?
I think the two that come to mind instantly, I think family is a huge support system. And even through my research, like just over the millennial generation, I saw that family systems and mothers and fathers were still very influential in actually young adults' lives, right? So sometimes I think we think, we don't want our parents or our parents get that impression, but what I found that we really still value our parents, right? And so we're still going to them for our opinions and just kind of as we form our own identity. So I think that's one. I think another one is just friends. We have a lot of friends. I think we're a very social type of generation, right? Social media alone will keep us connected, whether it's good connection or bad connection. Yeah. It keeps us connected still, right? And it's interesting because if 75% of our peers aren't engaged in the church, right? Well, I would then suspect that a lot of my support systems are not Christ-like, right? Mm-hmm. So that influence the identity, if they want to go to church on Sunday morning, it's just that's kind of blown out the window sometimes because my peers, my support system, don't find those things valuable.
Yeah.
And I wonder if just education and our work, we kind of find support in those places, right? So if our professors or our mentors in college as we're learning new things, I wonder if that's part of our new support system. But we do neglect the church, right?
Right, right.
You probably find that as well.
Yeah, so especially in my group of friends, the friends that I grew up with or the friends that I have now, a lot of them are not what you would call church people, I guess. Yeah. You wouldn't find them at church on a Sunday morning, but they still are an important part of my life and they form an important support structure for myself. I'm lucky enough to also have the church and my congregation that is very much a blessing to my life, but the friends and people a lot of my own age aren't in that support structure as well. So it is a different kind of parallel support structure, at least for myself and a lot of the other people in the church my own age. A lot of their friends and other support structures are not within the church as well.
Yeah, and I even wonder, I even think if we say our friends that are Christians are our support system, I wonder if even that's even varied, right? So we have those Christians who are really rooted, kind of always at the church, really religious, really spiritual, right? So they're part of our support system. But then we have those friends that call themselves Christians and they might go sometimes and they don't go. And I wonder if even there's varied among Christians, our support system, right? It's so diverse among our support system, but I think it's so great that you have kind of both, right?
Yeah. So do you think there's anything that the church can learn from those other support systems that young adults are getting, such as family or friends or things like work and school? Do you think there's anything that we can learn from that?
Yeah, I wonder, I think initially we would say, well, they would need the church, right? But I wonder, those things aren't bad, right? If the support system is at friends or family, in some ways that's good. It kind of gives us even a bigger picture of who we need to become, right? I'm just very fascinated. One of my strengths is input. I love to hear people's thoughts. So I love to hear what anyone has to say of all of my support systems, right? And I think if we learn a different perspective, I think for me to have friends that are not Christians, they don't allow me to be this sheltered Christian any longer. They kind of broaden my perspective, right? And so they can laugh at me when I'm being maybe too spiritual, too religious, and they tell me just to relax a little bit.
Yeah.
But I can kind of, we can work together, right? So I can tell them why I think what I want, and that's where that relationship come into, right? I can learn from them as well and know what the world's thinking and know how religious or unreligious the world really is, right? So I think it's really neat to have support systems all over the place to have the most biggest picture of who we are and who we need to become.
Cool. So we're going to actually back up for a second in our conversation. And we're actually going to talk about young adults in general, the actual term young adult. And so in the United Methodist Church, if you are one of those nerds who looks up at the discipline, for the United Methodist Church, young adults are people from the ages of 18 to 35 within the United States.
Okay.
And sometimes people take definitions like that and look at it as a specific age group and find that not very fulfilling and have used other terms. One of them is emerging adult. Can you talk a little bit about the difference between that very age-focused young adult term and something more like emerging adult?
Yeah, I really like the emerging adult language, right? So I think with young adult, there's just a stigma that they're an adult, yet they're just young as well, right? So they assume that they're just gonna be a full-fledged, mature, productive member of society at 18, right? So I always think about a time when I met with my grandma. I think we were in the car going to Philly to see my sister. I don't know what we were doing, but I remember vividly asking her, I said, "Gram, what was it like for you to become 18? When you were 18, what were the things we were doing?" And she said, well, I married your grandpa, he went off to war, I had a child, and I just had to become an adult, right? Mm-hmm. Never education, none of those things, right? But I think about my own, like, 18, well, I didn't get married, I didn't go off to war, I didn't have a child at home, I went off to college and I was a kid for another 4 years, mm-hmm. right? And so I wonder if emerging adult actually more kind of captures who we are right now, right? Because society is moving, right? So marriage is later, right? So 26, you know, the 30, mm-hmm. you know, I think the average for women who are having children are 27, right? Mm-hmm. So just being pushed, we're kind of forcing or kind of encouraging a lot of youth to go to college, right? So they have 4 more years of extended adolescence or extended maturing. Mm-hmm. And so I wonder if, like, saying that we are emerging into adulthood, to use it in that way, like, we are emerging into adulthood. We're allowed to stumble and fail and kind of figure things out. And then when we graduate college, guess what? We're probably going to go home and live with our parents for a little bit, right? Mm-hmm. Might live in their basement for a year to get our feet going, right? So yeah, I think the culture has allowed us to do that. So I think that's why even having this conversation is so crucial, because young adults are so different, right? So now we're emerging adults. So we have to think very differently about it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that talking about how that process can be very long and kind of be a little bit drawn out, and, or at least longer than people in previous generations, mm-hmm. I was thinking about one of the things that from the presentation, one of the statistics is people, or at least young adults, sometimes get a little wary when people or the church itself is overprotective of them. Do you have any stories or ideas about when that overprotectiveness of people within the church can harm the faith of a person who is a young adult or an emerging adult, whatever you want to call that?
Yeah, I think about a time when I was at Messiah College working my undergraduate degree, and mm-hmm. I was in a preaching class, and I can remember one of my peers who was preaching referenced a secular song mm-hmm. in his sermon. And I can remember sitting there as a good old evangelical boy mm-hmm. saying, you can't use a secular song in a Christian sermon, right?
Yeah.
And so I really processed that over the last couple of years. And You Lost Me has a story about a young musician who was very proud. He had like a record label or just had a recorded a song or something like that. Mm-hmm. And he was not, the song was not welcomed well into his faith community because it was a secular song. It was a love song to his girlfriend, right? Mm-hmm. That made it big. And so his home church thought he should be making Christian music, not secular music, right? Mm-hmm. So when I think about overprotectiveness, I think about that, right? Mm-hmm. That we have these kind of very exclusive thoughts that that we to be good Christians, we have to follow the right rules, and we have to do the right things, right? Mm-hmm. So I think we celebrate rightness. Like if you don't sin and you have a really clean mouth, and we kind of celebrate rightness, right? Mm-hmm. But we don't really celebrate holiness, right? Mm-hmm. So we focus on the roles and not, you know, holiness. And then if we're becoming more holy, then we'll become more right, right? Mm-hmm. But I think that we focus on the rightness. And so I just think about, you know, that time in that class where I just was perplexed by that. But now I'm thinking, like, how can we integrate more of that? Because Christianity is so much bigger than, you know, secular and sacred space, mm-hmm. right? So everything can be sacred, can't it, right? Yeah. I think this overprotecting of suit, we want to make sure everything that we do can be sacred, right? Mm-hmm. And so we don't want to continue to have these silos or fragments in our life.
Great. So talking a little bit more about trying to keep away those silos, one of the perceptions of the church that has been referenced a lot in mm-hmm. the statistics that you brought up was the idea of the church being anti-science. Mm-hmm. So can you talk a little bit about that perception, and how can the church get beyond that perception as mm-hmm. well?
Yeah, that's the anti-science is, you know, a really fascinating one, right?
Yeah.
I had a lunch with a young adult recently who is a huge, studied biology in college, mm-hmm. right? And so she was really wrestling with her faith of how to deal with what she's learning in school, like mm-hmm. evolution and the Big Bang Theory and just the progression of humans and how that related to the creation story, right?
Yeah.
And so initially, I one thing I did do in particular in my faith community, we preached about it this summer, right? Mm-hmm. And so really, I think we kind of juxtaposed these two, saying, well, creation is here, evolution is here, and we don't really talk about it, right?
Yeah,
we don't really talk about those two things, mm-hmm. yet we're being taught evolution in school. Mm-hmm. And so I wonder if having a kind of a healthy conversation on a continual basis of how to integrate science, because everything else in science we celebrate, right? Mm-hmm. Technology we celebrate, mm-hmm. modern medicine we celebrate. So we really value science, and I think the church would acknowledge that. But for some reason, creation in particular and evolution, we really wrestle with. Mm-hmm. And so I wonder if, like, that's the biggest thing, right? Mm-hmm. Churches aren't teaching me. I mean, I was never taught in high school youth group or church, like, how to wrestle those two, right? I mean, I never talked about those two, right? But I wonder if beginning to have some of those deep conversations, like how can we integrate the two of them, right? Mm-hmm. So could God, and I believe in a big God, could God use those things to create the world, right? And I think allowing conversation to be had around those two, not saying we have to agree about the different, these different things, but I wonder if like the conversation around science, around all of these different things that we feel to be anti-biblical or anti-God.
Okay.